Leadership for a Fractured World: How to Cross Boundaries, Build Bridges, and Lead Change. Written by Dean Williams. Narrated by Kevin Pierce. Foreword by His Holiness the Dalai Lama. Many of the world's problems and conflicts arise because we have lost sight of the basic humanity that binds us all together as a human family. We tend to forget that despite the diversity of race, religion, ideology, and so forth, people are equal in their basic wish for peace and happiness. When we see pictures of our blue planet from space, there are no signs of boundaries. It's a vivid illustration of the oneness of humanity. This is why we have to make the well-being of humanity our primary concern. We have efficient education and remarkable technological development, yet we still face many problems. None of us want these problems, but we seem to create them for ourselves. Why? Because we are too self-centered. We place too much stress on our own narrow interests, with not enough consideration for the needs of others. Today, despite ongoing conflicts and the threat of terrorism, most people are genuinely concerned about world peace, far less interested in propounding ideology, and far more committed to coexistence. During the 20th century, a greater number of human beings met their deaths through violence than at any other time, and the damage done to the natural environment was very serious. But as a result of these experiences, humanity is becoming more mature. This is evident in the growing concern for peace, nonviolence, and human rights. Even politicians increasingly talk about compassion and reconciliation. Despite a faltering start, the 21st century could become one of dialogue, one in which compassion, the seed of nonviolence, will be able to flourish. We may sometimes feel that we can solve a problem quickly by force, but such success is often achieved at the expense of the rights and welfare of others. One problem may have been solved, but the seed of another is planted, thus opening a new chapter in a cycle of violence and counterviolence. Preventive measures and restraint have to be adopted right from the start. Clearly, leaders need to be alert, far-sighted, and decisive. Mahatma Gandhi, who was such a leader, pointed out that if we are seriously interested in peace, it must be achieved through peaceful and nonviolent means. I believe that in ancient times, the status of men and women was more or less equal, with everyone sharing an equal load of work. Then, with the establishment of settled communities, power became a factor between them, and the basis for power was physical. Therefore, because they are generally physically stronger, men came to predominate. In modern times, with the introduction of education for all, the basis for power, survival, and improvement has been the brain, so the difference between men and women has changed and become less obvious. Now, when the world is so much more interdependent, compassion and warm-heartedness are required, and women have an equal responsibility to lead. In today's reality, the only way of resolving differences is through dialogue and compromise, through human understanding and humility. We need to address the gap between rich and poor. Inequality, with some sections of humanity living in abundance while others on the same planet go hungry, is morally wrong and practically a source of problems. Equally important is the issue of freedom. As long as there is no freedom in some parts of the world, there can be no real peace, and in a sense, no real freedom for the rest of the world. Perhaps the most important factors that inhibit us are short-sightedness, narrow-mindedness, and selfishness. The challenge for leaders is to help people transcend self-interest and the immediate interests of their group in order to collaborate and promote shared happiness. I hope and pray that readers of this book by Dean Williams will contribute to the good of the world by taking the initiative in giving a lead wherever they can to help our communities and societies solve the toughest problems. Peaceful living is about trusting those on whom we depend and caring for those who depend on us. If even a few individuals create mental peace and happiness within themselves and act responsibly and kind-heartedly toward others, they will have a positive influence in their community. Our goal should be a more peaceful and equitable world, not only for the present generation, but also for our children and the generations to come. Preface. This book is about helping people and groups that have great differences come together to solve shared problems. It is about providing leadership to address the interdependent challenges, real dangers, and abundant opportunities generated by the fractured, complex, and unpredictable world in which we live. Interdependent problems cannot be resolved by one group acting alone or in isolation, and therefore a new notion of leadership and change is needed. Today, we need to be global change agents. By global change agent, I do not mean someone crisscrossing the globe solving world problems, but anyone at the local or international level who has a broad mindset and is committed to making the world a better place. The global change agent, one, mobilizes people to cross the boundaries that divide groups to address shared problems. Two, helps groups bust the boundaries and maladaptive practices that keep people from effectively responding to emerging threats and the demands of a changing world. 3. Works with divided and fractured groups to build a relational bridge by healing wounds, reducing the mystery of the other, and resolving conflicts. And 4. Intervenes when a group is stuck to stimulate sufficient creativity to transcend confining boundaries to produce breakthrough solutions. Global change agents who can exercise leadership are needed at all levels of society and in all domains of human activity. The book is for leaders in business, politics, non-governmental organizations, NGOs, international organizations, education, and government. It is for anyone who must work across silos, divisions, and borders to exercise leadership. It is for those with considerable power who seek to lead from positions of authority, and for those with little power who seek to lead from the margins or at the grassroots. Fundamentally, the book is for those passionate and committed people who desire to contribute to a better world. The reality is that in so many areas our world is fractured, and small fault lines and deep chasms divide groups. There is much work to be done at both the local and international levels to fix what is broken, pursue value-adding opportunities, and help groups transcend their differences to create something of worth for all. The ideas and principles presented in this book have been shaped by conversations I've had with many leaders and change agents. At the Harvard Kennedy School, I chair the Global Change Agent Executive Education Program, and I've been enriched by the experiences and insights of the participants. I also direct the World Leaders Project based at the Center for Public Leadership, and have had the special opportunity to interview many leaders to get their advice and lessons. These include Gordon Brown of the United Kingdom, Lee Kuan Yew of Singapore, Mary Robinson of Ireland and the United Nations, Shimon Peres of Israel, Malcolm Fraser of Australia, Felipe Calderon of Mexico, Lech Walesa of Poland, and the Dalai Lama, to name just a few. I have also interviewed many change agents in business, public service, education, NGOs, and civil society. These are people at the forefront of change, whether as activists, organizers, educators, entrepreneurs, managers, thinkers, or innovators. The book also draws on my experience helping groups change. I've worked with many corporations on leadership development and cultural change to help them become more adaptive and globally competitive. I have participated in large-scale change initiatives in educational reform in Australia and the United States. I have also been an advisor to many different governments, including Nigeria, Brunei, and East Timor. For several years, I served as the chief advisor to the president of Madagascar, helping him facilitate the development of one of the poorest nations on the planet. Significant progress was being made until a rogue faction in the military launched an ugly coup in 2009. when it comes to leadership and change, I've seen the good, the bad, and the ugly. This book captures my insights. Leadership for a fractured world is a complex topic, and no single theory can do it justice. Therefore, I have adopted a multidisciplinary approach in the writing of this book by drawing on research and theories from anthropology, social psychology, human development, and business. The book is also a contribution to the adaptive leadership framework as first articulated by Ronald Heifetz and Riley Sinder in their seminal paper that distinguished leadership from authority and technical work from adaptive work. Both are my friends, colleagues, and collaborators, and we continue to work together to push the frontier of the understanding and teaching of adaptive leadership. How should you use this book? I have not written it with the intent of giving clear-cut prescriptive answers, as one might do in writing about performance management, where the problem and goals are clear. This is a book about addressing messy, adaptive problems that have no clear textbook answers. I present guidelines, ideas, and cases that illustrate ways to think about how to approach these kinds of problems. By describing an array of cases of men and women succeeding or failing in a variety of contexts, I hope that you, the reader, will draw connections to your own particular leadership challenges. Think about what the boundaries are that confine or limit you, your group, or organization. Think about the boundaries that need to be crossed, busted, or transcended. Think about the kind of leadership you need to provide to make the world a better place. I hope the principles presented will help you on your leadership journey. Introduction. It's a crazy, fractured world. There is nothing more difficult to take in hand, more perilous to conduct, or more uncertain in its success than to take the lead in the introduction of a new order of things. Niccolò Machiavelli, 1469 to 1527. It's a crazy world, and it is a fractured world, and we all feel the stress and see the fractures, and frustratingly ask, where is the leadership? I've been wrestling with this question for a long time. As a young doctoral student, I lived for a time in the remote rainforests of Borneo with a nomadic tribe called the Penan, where I studied social and cultural adaptation. The Penan hunted with a blowpipe, wore a simple loincloth, and had boar tusks protruding through their pierced earlobes. One evening, eating sago palm and roasted monkey around the campfire and telling stories, a small group of Penan young men arrived after having spent a month away working for a logging company. They brought with them a boombox, and I shall never forget when they turned it on and Madonna's voice could be heard screeching through the forest, like a virgin touched for the very first time. As she sang, I thought, this is surreal and depressing, as the Penan's life will never be the same. The intrusive aspects of globalization had disrupted the Penan's life, and also disrupted one of the world's most magnificent and essential rainforests. And not just because of Madonna's singing, but because of the competition of diverse groups for scarce and valuable resources. The developed nations of the world wanted the hardwoods in the Penan's forest for the building of houses and furniture. The government wanted the revenues from deforestation for development. And entrepreneurial businessmen and some politicians saw an unprecedented opportunity to make a quick profit. Saving the forest and ensuring the Penan had a say in their future was a complex challenge involving many groups with competing priorities and values: the local government, environmental activists, the World Bank, the nations that purchase the timber, and of course the Penan themselves. The reality is that even though media technology is breaking down boundaries and connecting us in unprecedented ways, fractures are abundant, and all groups are in a state of volatility and vulnerability, whether it is the Penan of Borneo or an investment bank on Wall Street. Today, we need men and women who have the courage and the capacity to orchestrate multidimensional problem solving and change to address complex challenges. This is a different kind of leadership than what we've become accustomed to. Traditional forms of leadership, in particular what I call big man leadership, tend to advance the interests of one group over another and inadvertently perpetuate fractures and divisions. Fractures and divisions are reinforced by group boundaries. Boundaries could be professional, structural, cultural, ideological, ethnic, gender, or religious boundaries, to name just a few. They create and protect spaces within which coordinated work and living processes take place. A boundary is a form of constraint, but it is also a frontier. As a frontier, it presents fascinating opportunities for exploration, learning, expansion, and creative discovery. To mobilize people to address interdependent challenges and to orchestrate change, leaders work at the boundaries. While traditional leaders reinforce boundaries, change agents exercise leadership to help groups expand boundaries, cross divides, and build bridges to address shared challenges. If groups and institutions do not have enough people providing leadership to address fractures and to mobilize people to tackle interdependent problems, they will fail to deliver on their promise, persist in a state of mediocrity, and might even collapse. They will certainly not be as productive as they could be. For example, a multinational software company that I advise is struggling with the challenge of being a truly global company. It has more than 10,000 employees in different parts of the world. The dilemma is that internal silos inhibit the communication, coordination, and problem-solving needed to take the company to the next level of performance, innovation, and profitability. Many of the executives, by inclination or preference, stay within their group enclave, get stuck or lost in hierarchy and procedure, and do not display the initiative needed to cross boundaries and build the relationships needed to produce innovative breakthroughs for the company. A senior human resource executive who saw this pattern as a high priority challenge asked me, "How can we shake these people out of their comfort zones and get them to be global leaders of change?" Companies are not alone in this challenge. Educational systems, governments, and every group or tribe in the world today face the challenge of dealing with complexity, interdependence, inhibiting boundaries, and the demands for change. Whether you are the police chief in Ferguson, Missouri, a community activist in Bogota, Colombia, a school principal in Geelong, Australia, the mayor of Beijing, the head of an NGO in Liberia, a software engineer in Silicon Valley, or a businessman in Tokyo, you must learn how to provide change agent leadership to address the array of complex problems and challenges facing your particular group, organization, or community. Chapter 1 of this book talks about why the world is a crazy and fractured place. It explains how the cultural drift of groups, the habitual ways of thinking and operating, thwarts problem solving and creative work as it pertains to addressing interdependent challenges. The chapter explains why big man leadership, the expression of prominence, dominance, and tribalizing, is insufficient for dealing with complex problems, and why global change agents are needed. Chapter 2 addresses the diagnostic work needed to figure out where the fractures are and why they persist. It explores how cultural practices, sacred values, and group narratives generate divisions between groups, reinforce group boundaries, and impede interdependent problem solving. The chapter presents a diagnostic framework for analyzing group dynamics and determining both the adaptive and maladaptive features of group behavior. Maladaptive group features will need to be modified, while adaptive features can be leveraged to support the work of problem solving and change. Chapter 3 presents the specific leadership challenge of crossing boundaries. To provide leadership, You must cross multiple boundaries to mobilize diverse groups to tackle interdependent problems. Crossing boundaries is not easy or natural. It can also be risky because you must leave a state of predictability and safety for a state of vulnerability and uncertainty. You need to be responsible for what blessing or threat you represent to diverse groups and find wise partners to help navigate the terrain and deal with boundary keepers if you're to succeed in your leadership efforts. Chapter 4 explains the leadership challenge of busting boundaries. Boundaries are reinforced by group values, habits, and practices. They can be like walls that limit people's capacity to see and respond to the realities of changing conditions, new threats, and exciting opportunities. Group members might not consider the boundary as a constraint, but as a welcome, protective barrier that allows them to continue doing what they always have done. The task of the change agent is to challenge one's own group's boundaries, help people appreciate what is at stake if they do not change, and work with them to eliminate those practices that reduce their capacity to connect, adapt, and succeed. Chapter 5 presents the leadership challenge of transcending boundaries. Transcending boundaries is creative work. It is about helping the group depart from the familiar and venture into unfamiliar terrain with a spirit of exploration, experimentation, and discovery. It includes harnessing the power of diversity to engage in innovation to generate novel and breakthrough solutions. Chapter 6 presents the leadership challenge of building a bridge between groups. Enmity, or the fact that different groups are simply a mystery to one another, may cause or perpetuate a deep divide between groups. Wounds must be healed. The mystery must be reduced. Relationships must be rebuilt, and collaborative work on behalf of a shared future must begin. Chapter 7 explains how to expand your personal boundaries in order to increase your capacity to provide leadership for a crazy and fractured world. Leadership requires getting others to expand, bust, and transcend boundaries. But if you cannot do likewise, how can you lead? Expanding personal boundaries is about broadening your mindset to become more globally oriented, developing in cultural and moral wisdom, and enhancing your capacity to operate in complex, chaotic, and diverse environments. Chapter 8, the final chapter, speaks to how to keep oneself from fracturing or succumbing to the strain of leading in a crazy world. In exercising leadership as a global change agent, it is easy to get tired, become cynical, burn out, or give up. The burden of responsibility, as well as the risk and danger, cannot be taken out of the work. But you can increase your capacity, effectiveness, and resilience in the face of these demands. Your personal challenge is not only to survive, but to thrive, and to find joy and satisfaction in this noble work of making the world a better place. Part 1. Preparation. Chapter 1. What Leadership for a Fractured World Entails. The world, in so many ways, is fractured. The fractures in groups and between groups could be wide fractures that divide, hairline fractures that generate a state of susceptibility and vulnerability, or latent fault lines that can crack open when some sudden change erupts due to internal or external pressure. Many groups, institutions, and communities are in a fractured state in varying degrees. Somehow we seem to hobble along, but the reality is few things quite live up to their promise. In fact, what we repeatedly see are systems breaking down, be they institutional systems, economic systems, political systems, or environmental systems, to name a few. And we all frustratingly ask, where is the leadership? to provide leadership for a fractured world, we need a different way to think about leadership. We cannot think of leadership exclusively in terms of the big man or the tribal boss who represents the interests of their group alone. We need to distinguish real leadership from formal authority. Leaders today must be agents of change who are willing and able to cross boundaries, connect groups, and orchestrate multidimensional problem-solving and change. Without that kind of leadership, the fractures that separate us will only get worse. Leadership is needed to help groups transcend the tribal impulse to solve interdependent problems. Most people do not fully appreciate the systemic nature of their problems. We think and act parochially. The cultures of our respective groups and the respective roles we play in these groups often cause us to view problems through the narrow and myopic lens of immediate self or group interest. Consequently, groups are inclined to see only pieces of a complex problem and end up working on their own small bit without making much headway. Even though we live in a globalized world, in many ways we are still very tribal. By tribal, I mean that we affiliate ourselves with groups that inform our identity and from which we derive meaning. These days, many of us belong to multiple tribes: the company tribe, the church tribe, the family tribe, and even many online tribes. Tribal groups, since the beginning of time, have been important for community and security. When a group gets too big or amorphous, it is easy to get lost and feel uneasy. So, for biological, psychological, and cultural reasons, we retreat to the safety of some form of an identity group or tribe. Social science research on group behavior supports the notion of tribalism and explains how it generates in-groups and out-groups. The renowned Harvard biologist and naturalist E.O. Wilson has articulated the tribal impulse by arguing that as human beings, we have innate tendencies, predispositions, and emotional capacities that lead us to identify with a group or tribe that provides fellowship, protection, coordinating mechanisms, parameters for action, and frameworks for interpreting the human experience. While tribal by nature, we are willing to create networks of tribes to expand boundaries, colonize territory, engage in trade and agriculture, and go to war and defeat enemies. In his insightful book, Moral Tribes, Joshua Green, who directs the Moral Cognition Lab at Harvard, describes how our brains are designed for tribal life, leading us to make choices to advance our own group's interests at the expense of others, and to rationalize such behavior as appropriate and moral. The tribal impulse indicates that we want to be around people who are similar to us in terms of values, looks, language, humor, food, and desires. The tribal impulse can be seen even in progressive places such as Belgium, the nation whose capital houses the headquarters for the European Union. The EU offices in Brussels may symbolize unity, yet all is not well in Belgium. Some Dutch-speaking people of the Flanders region want to separate from the French-speaking people of the Walloon region. Their tensions are rooted in historical, economic, cultural, linguistic, and political differences. Rather than do the hard work of learning from one another and maintaining a viable and thriving nation, too many people would prefer to call it a day and retreat to what they believe to be the safe confines of their tribal identity. The tribal impulse is evident in commercial enterprises too, as it pertains to professions and departments. Conducting research at a major American newspaper, I noticed how the suspicions between the journalists and editors on one side and the business managers and marketing people on the other side kept the two groups from talking to one another. In fact, they worked on different floors to avoid interaction. What surprised me was the intensity of the contempt each group had for the other. The journalists, detested the fact the business people made decisions based on market demographics and advertising revenues. The business people deplored how ignorant or naive journalists could be about the realities of running a company that had to make money in order to survive. Being tribally oriented is not a bad thing. In fact, it has many benefits. The problem, however, is that many of the challenges that we face today cannot be resolved if we think parochially and act tribally. The tribal impulse is reinforced by group boundaries. These boundaries make addressing systemic, interdependent challenges very difficult. There are many kinds of boundaries, including religious, cultural, professional, geographic, economic, class, and ethnic boundaries. Every group has a boundary. Nature has boundaries, and all organisms have boundaries. The boundary protects the space that allows group activity to take place. If a boundary is absent or too permeable, the group or organism is weakened and could die or simply disappear. While boundaries are essential for distinguishing group membership and for coordinating domains of group activity, their function is to keep some people in and others out. They work well in helping groups engage in routine problem solving, but they can be constraining and burdensome when dealing with interdependent problems. Complexity does not honor boundaries, but transcends them, as with a global financial crisis, a virus such as Ebola, sectarian warfare, or environmental pollution. If people are unwilling to transcend their boundaries and address an interdependent problem, they put at risk not only their own group, but the entire system. Recently, I met with some managers from one of the world's leading multinational software companies who were struggling to deal with a complicated challenge where a division overseas was having difficulty in getting its perspectives heard in the headquarters. By virtue of the reluctance to open the boundary and let the foreign perspective be included in the problem-solving and strategy-formulating processes of headquarters, vital data were not being considered, which in turn had an impact on overall company performance. This is a problem every large company struggles with. Boundaries that inhibit performance develop easily. Managers in such environments can become excessively parochial, operating mostly within their boundaries and seeing no reason to cross boundaries, bust boundaries, or join with others to address a shared challenge. In boundary-laden organizations, silos begin to emerge that become rigid barriers to success. These silos lead people to engage in protective games, petty politics, and turf battles, which are activities that add no value to the organization, but actually diminish value. Globalization is breaking down many boundaries, yet many old fractures persist, and new fractures are being generated. Former UK Prime Minister Gordon Brown stated that globalization has generated opposite gravitational poles of production and consumption, and today the world arrangements look unbalanced and unsustainable. He added that while there are benefits to globalization, they cannot be secured without a willingness to address at a global level the underlying economic, democratic, social, and political weaknesses of globalization. In other words, the problems generated by globalization are complex, interdependent, and systemic in nature, and cannot be resolved by thinking parochially or acting tribally. Before the global financial crisis of 2008, Brown saw the need to get financial regulators to work together at a global level to understand the true scale of risk and act on it by creating an early warning system. I will forever regret my failure to bring other countries on board or persuade them of the urgency of action, he lamented. I can see with hindsight that it was impossible to build an international consensus. Leadership is needed to help groups generate shared progress. While the tribal impulse is natural and brings many benefits. Problems arise when groups pursue their goals without concern for the interests of other groups due to very different and often competing notions of progress. Progress, according to the dictionary, means a move toward a higher or better state. Any human, organizational, social, political, or economic system will contain differences of opinion about what is meant by higher or better, and the pathway for producing progress. For example, the prevailing belief among some groups is that democracy is the essential engine to generate progress throughout the world. But as we have seen in Iraq and Afghanistan, American-style democracy cannot succeed without deep learning work to modify the values, perceptions, and priorities of multiple groups. And there are some groups that believe that progress can only be achieved by coercively getting other groups to abide by their beliefs, and should they refuse, they need to be eradicated, as we have witnessed with radical religious groups in Iraq and Syria. In the context of the United States, the Republicans have one view of progress, and the Democrats have another view. And within each of these groups are sub-factions with their own particular beliefs about what progress is and how to generate it. Healthy debate and the exchange of perspectives is a good thing. But when groups demand that their view of progress is the right one and the view of other factions is flawed or outright wrong, then the divisions make shared problem-solving impossible. In 2013, for example, the fractured political culture in Washington led to a government shutdown when Congress failed to enact legislation to appropriate funds for the fiscal year. People's definitions of progress are informed by their cultural heritage, group values, and personal aspirations. It is not enough to say that we all want the same thing. We do not all want the same thing. As the previous examples indicate, even if our notions of progress are similar, the strategies and actions for producing progress may differ radically. A leadership challenge is to keep groups from defining progress in narrow, parochial terms, such as winning or beating the competition, and to view progress as making things sustainably better for all. In the context of an interdependent world, if you are attaining your goal through destructive competition, then instead of getting practical results, you might be setting the conditions for ongoing conflict and great loss to your own group and to others. Leadership is needed to fix a maladaptive cultural drift. Sometimes the impediment to progress lies in the deficient problem-solving processes embedded in the cultural drift of groups. All tribes, groups, and institutions have what I call a cultural drift. The cultural drift is the group's shared, taken-for-granted values, practices, and priorities. It is the habitual way of operating. Members of the group essentially drift along in its cultural river, without thinking deeply about the implications of their actions and choices, because the cultural drift provides a set of processes and procedures for solving routine problems and addressing predictable challenges. This patterned behavior might work well in some contexts, but be ineffective in others. Unless the group can modify its cultural drift to address complex, interdependent problems, a breakdown in the system could occur. To illustrate the power of the drift in shaping and constraining action, consider what happened when an earthquake and tsunami struck the east coast of Japan on March 11, 2011, leading also to a nuclear disaster at the Fukushima nuclear power plant. After the tsunami hit the plant, a meltdown occurred at 3 of the 6 nuclear reactors, releasing substantial amounts of radioactive materials into the environment and causing a mass evacuation of 200,000 people. An analysis by an independent commission concluded that while the tsunami triggered the event, it was also a man-made disaster That was the product of cultural, managerial, and regulatory deficiencies in the company, in the government, and between agencies. The chairman of the committee, Kiyoshi Kurikawa, stated, "What this report cannot fully convey, especially to a global audience, is the mindset that supported the negligence behind this disaster. What must be admitted, very painfully, is that this was a disaster made in Japan. Its fundamental causes are to be found in the ingrained conventions of Japanese culture, our reflexive obedience, our reluctance to question authority, our devotion to sticking with the program, our groupism, and our insularity." Chairman Kurikawa was particularly critical of the company that owned and ran the power plant, TEPCO. The report highlighted that management had a disregard for global trends and a disregard for public safety, and the company was a business that prioritized benefits to the organization at the expense of the public. His report was also tough on the government, pointing out that the breakdown was made worse because the agency responsible for promoting nuclear power was also the agency charged with regulating the industry. The conflict in interest resulted in the lack of best practice procedures and protocols needed to maximize safeguards and minimize the possibility of a disaster. The report also drew attention to the fact that Japan's democratic processes were deficient, in that the people's dissenting voices were not heard in a robust public discussion. Greater community participation and a strong civil society might have served as a watchdog to cast light on the flaws in government, industry, and prevailing cultural problem-solving practices pertaining to nuclear energy. But Japanese political authorities have never encouraged or valued groups agitating from the sidelines or raising potentially embarrassing or threatening questions. The report illustrates that the cultural drift that had served the country and its institutions well for generations, and still does for many challenges, had some maladaptive features that exacerbated the calamity. Japan and TEPCO are not unusual. Authority figures in all groups, institutions, and cultures generally protect and promote the prevailing cultural drift as it pertains to problem-solving and decision-making, even if it has maladaptive features. Groups, governments, and companies need adaptive and responsive cultural drifts. Given that it is a high-velocity world with extraordinary opportunities suddenly appearing and just as quickly disappearing, groups must be able to respond with speed and precision. For corporations, it is the age of hyper-competition. The abundance of new knowledge and technologies generates rich possibilities. Yet human nature, the fractures that divide us, and the flawed features of the cultural drift of institutions make it difficult to capitalize on these advances to produce advantage for all. There is too much prominence, dominance, and tribalizing, and too little leadership. Where is the leadership to address the problems of a fractured world? What is leadership? If a Martian were to say, "Take me to your leader," most people would probably take them to the dominant authority figure of a group, organization, or community. They would not necessarily take them to the provocative change agent who may have little status, but is courageously crossing boundaries, asking tough questions, and seeking to mobilize diverse groups to face reality and tackle messy, shared problems that endanger a group or community. They would think the direction-setting, charismatic harmonizer who gets everyone marching in the same direction is the leader. Indeed, most people generally think of the traditional, strong, boundary-reinforcing boss as the leader. It might be an expression of leadership, but it is what I term big man leadership, and it has both strengths and weaknesses. At its essence, big man leadership is about power, position, and formal authority. The conventional notion of leadership in most institutions and societies places the burden of direction setting, problem solving, and decision making on a dominant individual or elite group. The so-called leader is expected to show the way forward, protect the group, maintain group boundaries, and solve problems with minimal disruption to people's lives. His or her role is to be a symbol of the group's ideals and to act in ways that advance the group's interests, even if it is at the expense of other groups or the broader system. For many problems, big man leadership and the expression of formal authority is adequate to drive disparate groups to focus on the right set of tasks to achieve shared objectives. Today, however, power is dispersed, and the world is too complex to rely exclusively on big man leadership. Leadership depth and breadth is needed. The default strategy of big man leadership as it pertains to dealing with problems is generally through the expression of prominence, look to me, I'll fix the problem, dominance, listen to me, do what I say, and tribalizing, follow me, I'll advance your interests. Libya's Muammar Gaddafi is an extreme example, but the essence of his behavior illustrates the way many big man leaders operate as they go about the work of problem solving and change. I once sat next to Colonel Gaddafi and his team for 3 days at an African Union meeting in Ghana. He was a surreal character in his extravagant flowing robes. When Gaddafi stood to address his fellow African heads of state, he received a standing ovation for different reasons.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.